Good morning and welcome to the global influence of the African-American culture. It's pretty interesting how a very small group of people really can influence all corners of the globe. And I'd like to share with you some areas and we do that. And it's going to be five areas. I'm going to share with you the power of sports, societal and political. I'm going to talk about fashion. I'm going to talk about music and culture. And lastly, social justice and civil rights. But first, I'd like to share a wonderful spot that Google did for the Super Bowl last year that I think really says a lot.
I'm telling y'all ready.
Just like life. All right.
Air Jordan ready to take off.
Yeah, Google did a wonderful job of just portraying the power of African-Americans and what they've done. And they did that for Black History Month. But I just want to show when you see all those people together, you can see the strong influence. But let's start at when you think about it, when I looked at all those images, two words came up, and that's Black power. Not Black power in the political sense, but just the power of Blackness can do when you see it all together, just like you saw in the previous spot. But let's talk about how this all started. You got to think about it, right? You got to think about, you know, over 400 years ago, a group of 20 Africans was brought to America against their will, you know, stripped of their language and stripped of their culture. And you got to think about how someone who was brought over to a country in chains has excelled to have so much influence on the world. Going back to fast forwarding from 1619 all the way to 1968, something happened on the world stage. And this was during the 1968 Mexico Olympics when Tony Smith and John Carlos raised their hand as a Black Power salute. And what it said to the entire world that African Americans in this country was not being treated properly. And I bring that up because sports have really been a catalyst for projecting culture throughout the world and influence. You go all the way back to Jesse Owens in the 1936 Berlin Olympics, when Adolf Hitler was preaching about the white myth of superiority. And you had Jesse Owens just break that barrier at that time when Hitler turned his back to him. But right then and there, through the power of sports, you saw the influence of the world. And you think about today, we have a term in America called straight out of Compton, which is straight out of the ghetto or straight out of the hood. And these two little skinny Black girls that came straight out of a poverty-stricken community have excelled to a world stage. And that's Venus and Serena Williams. So you can see the influence of sports and how it's done to change the world and influence the world. And everyone should know this, man, if you're a basketball fan or not, but that's Michael Jordan, simply known as MJ, known as one of the best basketball player to ever play on the planet. He single-handedly made the Nike company the billionaire company that it is, and he single-handedly just exposed basketball to the world stage, where you have kids coming from everywhere to play basketball. As far as China, Yugoslavia, everybody. So he really just put the NBA on his shoulder. And just think about the cultural impact that that had on sports and how it changed the game. Now I like to go from sports to talk about societal and political boundaries, really. When you think about it, back to these enslaved people and what has happened to really make a change when it comes to society and politics. Think about this for a second. This is from our friends in the UK, if anybody from the UK is on. You go back to 2018 when Prince Harry took a bite out of soul food, as I say, and married a black woman and brought her over to England. You think about a royal wedding. You know, all the beautiful royal weddings, I've never seen any black people in them. But you can see that once blackness kind of stepped into the royal family, you can see what Meghan brought, right? She brought the bottom left, this black preacher from the south side of Chicago, which is the town I'm in now. You brought in a black choir, a black cellist. Now, I'm quite sure from this point on, and you all know in the UK, you've probably never seen this much blackness at a royal wedding, and you probably won't ever see it again. But again, the world stage, and the black influence on a royal wedding. And it was quite sure like a royal wedding like no other. You got to think about, again, here's this black man that became the leader, President Obama, of the free world. You know, his people came over as slaves 400 some years later. He's actually president of the United States, you know, so-called the most powerful nation on earth. But what an influence, right? So many people can say, so many little kids of color, ethnic backgrounds can say, wow, there's no limit to what I can do. And right on the heels of that, in this election, something even more interesting for this country, and I know some of the other countries in this world have had female leaders, but not in this country, not in the United States. And especially here's a woman coming from African descent as well as Indian. So being the first female, the first black woman, first woman of Indian descent. And it's very interesting from a global point of view is that when you, on the right-hand side, you can see that's where her, a village in India where her mother was from, really celebrated her. So again, you see the influence on the globalness of, I mean, the effect, the influence on a global stage is all coming from African Americans. Fashion. Now, this is a good one. You know, this person here is named Dapper Dan. Now, when you think about Gucci, Chanel, Louis Vuitton, there's very like, you know, she brands, right? Stuck up rich white people, you know, but, you know, fashion kind of hit a speed bump, right? Because they began to lose the coolness of it. So Gucci tapped into Dapper Dan, and Dapper Dan is known for taking high fashion and turning it on to the hip hop world. But it's interesting, you know, that so many fashion houses, you know, that's definitely in Europe, have tapped into black culture to make them cool again. And yeah, this is a page off the Gucci page now. Look at this cool Gucci, where it used to be Gucci locals with rich white guys working and, you know, walking through the French Riviera. Now you got Gucci, it's attached itself to streetwear, where it looks really cool. And we call this look over here ghetto fabulous. Music and culture. Now this is a good one. Hip hop. Oh God, hip hop started in 1984 out of New York City. And as you know, it's just really taking the world by storm. You can go anywhere, everywhere over this globe, and you can see young kids and youth culture that's picked up on hip hop. Hip hop is more than music. Hip hop is a lifestyle. It comes with dressing a certain way. You know, there's a certain body language to it. There's a certain language itself, as well as the music. And hip hop is the best-selling music genre in the world. And that says a whole lot for something that started in the hood in New York City. And just showing the globalness, if I love this shot, this guy is named Lilo. And I love this. You can see there's so many tentacles of hip hop. And one is dance called breaking, right? And here's this French B-boy. His name is Lilo. He's Algerian and French. And that again shows you how something that happens in Brooklyn, New York, translates all the way across the other side of the globe you know, someone who's not African-American, and he's one of the best B-boys in the world. I just want to show you a little clip of him to show you how great he is.
Yeah. Look, lately I went missing with no permission, it's part of it. I've been working harder than competition from start of it. Now they looking at me, I see them all through the rear view. Kill yourself to get your spot, then they die to be near you. They think that I made it, cause I made it past them. They were never the target, my target is past them. They laugh, but they laugh too when they talk to me back then. Guess it's deja vu, I'll be back when I lap them. Hate that I acknowledge haters, call it a curse. I'm on a search for validation, guess I don't know how this works, but I'm learning on the job. You can never please them all, I see why rappers get them.
And you cannot talk about global influence unless you talk about the king of pop, right? The king of pop, Michael Jackson. Oh man, no matter where he would go, Wembley Stadium, nope, doesn't matter. He sold out. I remember the day he passed away and the internet slowed down. Michael Jackson, MJ. And again, the power of influence. We got, and you know, you can't say MJ without talking, thinking about the Thriller dance, right? And just how this dance is celebrated still to this day all over the world. And Thriller is the best selling global album of all time. So you can't go to MJ without listening to him.
I'm scared.
It's close to midnight. Something evil's lurking in the dark.
Another moon. So you got to hear that. I mean, the Thriller, you just kind of groove. I hope everybody kind of doing that little zombie dance. It's all fun, right? Again, on the global stage. Then we come to Black Panther. When you get to entertainment, you know, this is the first Black superhero movie that did well globally. And the storyline, I don't know if you all saw it overseas or not, but it's really fantastic. You know, Marvel Comics has had this superhero for years, but they never made a movie out of him. And when they finally did, they had a blockbuster, a global blockbuster. In fact, it sold more, more tickets than the Titanic, which is huge. And as of 2019, you're looking at 1.3 billion, and that's 2019. So I'm quite sure that is increased since then. So again, the power of African-American, this great African story, you know, it was really fantastic. It gave Black kids, you know, an opportunity to feel good about themselves and just tell everybody that you can be a superhero irregardless of ethnic background. And you got to think about where we are in the world today when it comes to social justice and civil rights. You know, you go back to Martin Luther King days, as you saw in the Google spot about civil rights, but you can't talk about social justice without talking about Black Lives Matter. You know, Black Lives Matter started here in America because it was all about the unlawful killing, the police brutality of Black people in America. And it's so interesting how Black Lives Matter is now a global movement, because what you know and what we all know, so whether you're a minority in whatever country you are, you know you haven't been treated right. So this idea of Black Lives Matter travels. And as you can see, even though it started in the States, it's represented in over 60 countries across the world, everywhere but Antarctica. But who cares about that? But it's nothing but a bunch of penguins down there anyway. And I'm saying all of this is that, you know, for all the creatives on the phone and whatever we do, irregardless of what you do, you got to think about, if you look through the lens of any kind of project through the African-American experience, you can really see what it's about to be an American. You really can. But you have to look through those lens. And it's interesting, you know, we've all heard the line that pressure makes diamonds, right? And you got to think about the really painful, you know, history of the African-American. But it's probably through that pain that so many great things have come out of it when it comes to culture and innovation. So if you know, creative again, no matter what you're doing, if you look at the African-American experience as a toolkit for creativity, look at it. You got so many tools to innovate, so many tools to influence, and of course, so many tools to be highly creative. You know, we've looked at this. We've seen the power of sports. We've seen the power of hip hop and music. You know, we've seen what that has done to spur great ideas and great creativity. So really look at it through those lens, and you really see it's a wonderful toolbox, no matter where you are on planet Earth. But I'm going to say this, and I'm going to say this to everybody. African-American culture is very delicate. If you choose to look at your project through those lens, you know, or to use this influence in any way, I ask you to treat her with respect. The culture has been battered, but yet it still prevails. Treat it with respect. So many people tap into the culture, make fun of it, don't respect it, or just visit it, use it for what it is, and throw it away. Treat her with respect. And saying that, there's one more film I'd like you all to see. And it's by Beats, which is a headphone that Dr. Dre, who's a hip hop artist, created, and he sold it to Apple for billions of dollars. But it's a wonderful ad. It's on YouTube. It just began to run maybe a week or so ago. But it really summates who we are and how we feel. Take a look.
You love me. You love me not. You love black culture. But do you love me? You love how I sound. My voice, these beats, this flow. Not me though, right? You love how I look, my hair, this skin. But me, nah. We don't get to exist. We're forced to survive. We still fight. We still play while the world burns. On fields that ain't even level. All men are created equal. That's my favorite part. You hate us so deeply, but you're still so impressed. Why can't you see? There's history in our skin. You built this country on our backs. I'm him. He's me. She, us, we are all black. Black. Love me or not, we love each other deeply. We gon' be us. We gon' break bread. We gon' defy gravity. You love my culture, but do you love me? What a world that would be.
Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed it.